Hello everyone, this is our Be Smart in DFT lecture series and here we are with lecture number 2. As promised before, the aim of this lecture series are to make you smart in your research and to make you so efficient that you can interact knowledgeably with your collaborator. Also, after this lecture series, your package manual will express it in a much familiar way. And throughout the lecture series, we will try to stick to concepts and some very few easy mathematics. To derive the maximum gain from this video, sit calm and concentrated. Also, don't lose the flow and complete this video uninterrupted. Now, just a briefest recap. In the previous lecture, we had seen the Weinberg-Kohn theorems. First, HK theorem says, the ground state energy from Schrodinger equation is a unique functional of the electron density. It's okay, but which functional should be used? That problem was solved by the second theorem of Weinberg and Kohn, which says the electron density that minimizes the energy of the overall functional is the electron density you should use. Well, this is all and everything till now what we know. Let's take a look at what we don't know. We were happy to know that there is a clear one-to-one mapping between electron density and the wave functions. It is indeed physically sound, but it is only the kind of result which saves hardcore theoreticians from having sleepless nights, because still we don't know how to accomplish this mapping. In fact, after all this, you are simply clueless about how the functional should be constructed. Even if a superhuman comes to you and provide you the needed electron density, still you will have no idea about the wave functions, because it's okay that there is an exact one-to-one mapping, but where is the set of wave functions within which we should search? And introducing electron density saved us from using 3n dimensions only. But still you have to deal with many electron interactions. So practically still we are at the same obscurity as before. Now here starts the second interesting part of the story. In the summer of 1964, after taking an interval at France, our beloved Professor Kohn came to San Diego. And there he met his new postdoctoral student Liu Sham. In 1965, 1 year of intellectual and deliberate discussion between them resulted in the historical paper, which was mainly responsible for the Nobel Prize of Kohn. Actually, this was the paper which created a bridge between the mathematical formulation and the physical reality. Let's try to understand how genius this was. Depending on your textbook, from the very first or second chapter of quantum mechanics, you know that for each simple and non-interacting electron, the Schrodinger equation is given by minus h cut square by twice m grad square plus v equal to e psi or epsilon psi. This is our equation number 2.1. Now, for a large system, the total energy is given by e equal to summation over epsilon I, or sum of individual electron energy is the total energy. This is our equation number 2.2. The real genius trick played was to take a fictitious system in which the electrons are non-interacting, and the error that will be introduced because of real interaction between electrons will be compensated later. So, the equation given by Kohn and Sham for interacting electrons is minus h cut square by twice m grad square plus v effective into psi equal to epsilon into psi. This is our equation number 2.3, where this v effective is the effective potential felt by each fictitious non-interacting electron and actually is the term that makes the error up. By changing v to v effective, the Schrodinger equation remains exactly same. But maybe you are thinking like, can we really do this? For those aspiring students, we will release a video and put the link here in maybe 3 to 4 days. Okay, now let us see it in a more intricate way. The total energy is made of two terms, namely E known and E unknown, or EXE. As you may have guessed already, the known part includes all the quantum mechanically non-interacting effects. Their main weightage of this part is given by T plus VNE plus VEE, where this T is the kinetic energy of the electrons. VNE is the interaction energy, non-quantum mechanical interaction energy between electrons and the nucleus. And this VEE is the Coulomb interaction between electrons, or say the Coulomb interaction of the electron density with itself. And this EXE is called the exchange correlation functional, which includes all the quantum mechanical interaction effects. Those are not included in the known terms. Now, let's focus on the exchange correlation functional only. This functional consists of two terms, delta T and delta V, where delta T is the compensatory correction to the kinetic energy and delta V is the correction to the potential energy. Now, let's try to first understand the term exchange. Okay. Say, you have two wave functions corresponding to two different same spin electrons. When the two wave functions are sufficiently apart from each other, then the situation is not quite interesting. But as soon as the functions come closer and overlap, the electrons feel a quantum mechanical repulsion from each other, which is actually the exchange force. This is the Pauli exclusion principle in play, and the phenomena is called Pauli repulsion. So the exchange term is mainly Pauli repulsion, and the correlation term gives the measurement of how much the movement of one electron is influenced by the presence of all other electrons. Anyway, the analytical calculation of this correlation energy is not possible till now. To get this, you have to calculate the total energy and then subtract the exchange energy from that. Okay, so the energy is a functional of electron density, and XE functional is a part of energy, then it's pretty obvious that the XE functional is dependent on electron density distribution. The exchange correlation potential is given by VXE equal to del EXE divided by del N, where EXE is the exchange correlation energy and VXE is the exchange correlation potential at a point R. This is our equation number 2.4. Before going further into exchange correlation, we will take a look on the self-consistency of the Kohn-Sham equation. To present a seminar on DFT, this is something you must have the knowledge of. Okay. In a sophisticated way, the Kohn-Sham equation is written as minus h cut square by 2sm grad square plus v plus vh plus vxe of phi I equal to epsilon I phi I, which is our equation number 2.5, where this VH is the electron-electron Coulomb interaction energy. Now, how the electron density interact with itself is called the Hartree potential. This Hartree potential is given by VH equal to E square integration over N divided by R minus R dash. Now, this term N is given by, as you know from our previous lecture, electron density N equal to 2 summation over phi I star into phi I. Now, see, to calculate this wave function, you have to know the Hartree potential. Now, to know the Hartree potential, you should know the electron density. But the electron density consists of phi. So that to know the electron density, you have to solve the Kohn-Sham equation. So, you are in an iterative process. And once you start the iteration with a trial electron density, the Kohn-Sham equation corrects itself. That is why it is said that the Kohn-Sham equation is self-consistent. Hope you understand. The simplest form of the exchange correlation functional is the local density approximation, abbreviated as LDA, in which the calculation is based on the simplest electron distribution, the homogeneous electron gas. Actually, the LDA is the mother of almost all approximation currently in use in DFT, as said by Walter Cohn in his Nobel lecture. In this approximation, the exchange correlation energy at each point in the system is the same as that of an uniform electron gas of the same density. The exchange correlation energy of the system is given by EXC of LDA equal to integration over n into epsilon XC into dr. Now see, from this you know that the exchange correlation potential how should look like. The exchange correlation potential is Vx equal to del Exc divided by del n, which gives just the product rule of derivative. You get Exc plus n into del Exc divided by del n. Now, actually, this LDA is the only case where the Xc functional can be derived exactly, and the LDA gives bond lengths and thus the geometries of the molecules and solids, typically with an astonishing accuracy of 1%. This is pretty surprising. As was thought previously, the LDA will give exact results for homogeneous electron gas and effective results only for the system in which density varies very slowly. But in practical field, LDA give extremely useful results for most applications. This was also mentioned by Walter Cohn in his Nobel lecture. Maybe you are becoming impatient and the question in your mind is how to choose the Xc functional. If you really want to know this, you have to wait for a few lectures, because you will be able to understand this only after few other things are clear to you. To get the next video as soon as possible, please subscribe to our channel. Thank you.